Stanley Cohen joins us now in our New York studio, veteran human rights attorney who brokered the secret talks aimed at winning Peter Kasich's release. We welcome you to Democracy Now!
Thank you for inviting me.
So what happened? Explain how it was that the man that the U.S. was also allowing you to speak with in these negotiations was then arrested by Jordan, and what did the U.S. do about that?
The truth may not be known for many years, but the reality of it is that we had negotiated a protocol between the Jordanian intelligence and the United States government, a five-point protocol which specifically permitted Sheikh Muqtasi, who is by some the most important jihadi, for lack of a better word, imam in the world, to specifically speak with one of his students, Turki Ben Ali, who is the Grand Mufti of ISIS. That was reduced to writing. We have the exchange of emails between the government and ourselves. After two or three days of negotiations around the terms and conditions of those discussions, while discussions were going on with Gitmo veterans in Kuwait with other people at the same time, I received an email that said, from the government, spoken to coworker on the ground, the talks are a go. The talks began. I saw on WhatsApps the exchanges of information, the discussions while I was in Jordan between Ben Ali and Muqtasi. It was clearly moving in the right direction. It didn't involve the exchange of money or anything else. This was going to be a personal request by Muqtasi in exchange for stopping his verbal attacks upon ISIS. From nowhere, after the Jordanians had approved of this negotiation, he was arrested. He was seized, the conditions being, although they changed, they said there were a variety of reasons for the arrest. It came down to the fact that he was talking to ISIS and he wasn't allowed to, despite the fact that we had a protocol agreed to by the U.S. government and the Jordanian government. At the same time, when I returned to Kuwait, Kuwaiti intelligence people moved in on ex-Gitmo people that were involved and threatened to arrest them if they continued negotiations or discussions with ISIS around two points. It wasn't just around the release of Peter Kasich. It was also around stopping the seizing of civilians, stopping the seizing of journalists, the beheading and capture of journalists and aid workers as a new process in the region.
When you say there was a protocol agreed to by the U.S. and Jordan, you had confirmation from the U.S. that they authorized the channel with this figure that you were dealing with?
We provided 100 pages of email exchanges between myself and a person who's a lead person with the FBI, which laid out the protocol, the five steps that were required in order for Muqtasi to do it, which after 2 days said the calls are a go. You can do it. Muqtasi began the calls. The calls were positive. It happened at the same time. Keep in mind, there had been no beheadings for 6 weeks. When I was told to come to the Middle East, we were told, we conveyed, I wasn't coming unless there was a guarantee that Mr. Kasich would be alive. And at that point, the beheadings would stop. For some 6 weeks, no one was beheaded. This was a protocol. It was negotiated. It was reduced to writing. It was shared with Sheikh Muqtasi. It was shared with Sheikh Qatada, another former al-Qaeda heavyweight, so to speak. And the talks were underway.
So talk about these talks, how they went when you were shuffling between Jordan and Kuwait.
Well, there are two different angles or approaches. One had to do with ex-Gitmo. Imagine you're an ex-Gitmo veteran. When I say veteran, you were a prisoner. People who had been tortured in Bagram, in Kandahar, in Gitmo, they made a decision. These are folks that I had worked with over the prior few years in some cases of mine. They made a decision it was in the best interest, for a whole lot of reasons, for these beheadings to stop. I was told to come to the Middle East. The people in Kuwait were negotiating with fighters, essentially, from ISIS, while I was told I had to go to Jordan to speak with Muqtasi and with Qatada, because if they were going to release anyone, ISIS, it would only come through discussions with Sheikh Muqtasi. I went. We met. There was a protocol set up. There were telephones that were purchased. There were communications that were underway. The government was aware of what was proceeding at all times. They made a request for the identity of the three people that Muqtasi was speaking with. He agreed to provide them. He provided them. The FBI had them. The discussions were underway. Not only were there no assassinate, no beheadings for 6 weeks at all, but al-Qaeda, for the first time, made public pronouncements calling for the saving of Mr. Kasich and the cessation of beheadings. So clearly there was positive movement underway that had nothing to do with money, that had nothing to do with buying freedom, that had it was all based upon a discussion between religious leaders who were opposed to the beheadings, opposed to the captures, and ISIS, their leadership, their religious leadership.
Why did Jordan say they arrested him, and what did the U.S. or didn't the U.S. do?
Well, initially, Jordan said they arrested Muqdisi because of a post that he had done a month before. I find it interesting, a post in which he called for unification because of the new crusades, meaning the bombings. I found it interesting that Jordan arrested him and told the U.S. it was okay and go for it and you can do it, knowing 2 days later he was to be arrested. After his arrest, I reached out to the government immediately, and I was very blunt. I said, you've just basically killed not you, but we've all been sandbagged. Someone needs to get on the phone, whether it's the White House or the State Department, pick up a phone, call Jordan, release Muqdisi, get these talks underway, get them moving once again. I'd had discussions again with people in Kuwait who took the same position. The discussions could proceed. We just needed to get Muqdisi back out. Muqdisi wasn't charged with acts of terrorism. He wasn't charged with any acts of conspiracy. Eventually, we found out he was essentially arrested because of the very communications and contacts that had been authorized by the United States and agreed to by Jordanian intelligence.
Can you talk about the geopolitical implications of these talks that you're brokering here? I mean, here you have figures aligned with al-Qaeda reaching out to figures aligned with ISIS who have been at odds. That speaks to a potential restoring of ties between the two.
Listen. The record of Sheikh Muqdisi in Qatar was very clear. They had absolutely no use for ISIS whatsoever. They found their tactics to be repugnant to Islam. This was not about a rapprochement. The United States has tried to argue that one of the problems is it would have been a rapprochement. Rapprochement was never on the table. There was a very public debate, at times very aggressive and offensive debate between ISIS and these other sheikhs. The agreement was that in exchange for the release of Mr. Kasich, for this new bridge, which was going to stop attacking journalists, stop attacking aid workers and civilians, they were going to tone down the debate. There was never a chance of any rapprochement, of the two groups merging, of creating a new sort of tsunami of terrorism. It just wasn't going to happen. As Sheikh Qatada has described ISIS, they're a bunch of thugs. They want nothing to do with them. These are the same people that had negotiated the release without money of 36 peacekeepers from a different group in the region just 6 months before. They were interested in a cessation of these types of violent, un-Islamic beheadings and capturings of civilians. This was not about ever a reunification of two groups that were fighting each other.
So what did the U.S. say to you when you said you've got to get on the phone to Jordan and have him released?
We can't get involved. Nonsense. 3 weeks later, the president is sitting there with Abdullah in the White House, giving him an extra $400 million a year for 10 years to lead the ISIS battle. The United States made a decision. I don't know if it was the White House. I don't know if it was the State Department. They made a decision to throw Mr. Kasich under the bus because, for whatever reason, the Jordanian government did not want this to happen. Now, I have my own theory. My theory is simple, that there are surrogate states in the region that were very much concerned about non-state actors, such as these persons, being able to accomplish what they couldn't accomplish, which would have caused them tremendous loss of financial aid from the U.S. They didn't want it to happen. They prevented it from happening. And I'm convinced that had Sheikh Muqdisi not been arrested, Mr. Kasich would have been saved, and there would have been a cessation of these practices.
And where is Sheikh Muqdisi today?
He's still in prison. He's in Jordan. Every 15 days, he sees an intelligence judge who just renews it.
What about the motive of the U.S.?
Well, there are some who believe that the U.S. didn't want it to happen, that they were afraid of this rapprochement, that they wanted the best of all worlds. They wanted to be able to say, we're trying an innovative approach to obtain the release. They were shocked at the speed by which we really moved. This occurred within a 17-day period. We're not talking about a year and a half. And eventually, the United States made a decision, someone in the U.S. made a decision, we're not going to change our geopolitical policies, we're not going to tell Jordan what to do, and Mr. Kasich died.
Stanley Cohen, you are facing 18 months in prison right now. Mm-hmm. Next week, you mm-hmm. go to jail for tax evasion.
Not tax evasion. Impeding the IRS code.
do you feel there's any connection between what you're going to be serving time for and the kind of work you've been doing over these
years? Anyone who knows me knows I've been harassed for 15 years. The investigation into my work for Hamas started more than 15 years ago with clients harassed, with people being told if they gave me up, they'd get out of jail. There's been a steady practice, raids on my office. There's been monitoring that's going on. There's been harassment of my family. It's caused tremendous time and effort in terms of my practice. I find it interesting, the disconnect between me, who supposedly is this person who put his own interests ahead of the U.S. government, but when it came to my going to the region, when it came to the U.S. government making decisions on the basis of my recommendation, there was no problem whatsoever. I was assigned to a federal judge that I'd been fighting with for 20 years. There were prosecutors that were assigned to this case that were recently called liars by federal judges. Anyone who knows me knows the concept of me, who's done so much pro bono work, especially in the Middle East, being engaged in obstruction of tax, knows it's rubbish.
We want to thank you for being with us. Stanley Cohen, veteran human rights attorney, brokered the secret talks for Peter Kasich's release. Ultimately, those talks failed, and Peter Kasich was beheaded. Stanley Cohen begins serving an 18-month prison term over tax offenses, a case he says is politically motivated based on his years of taking on controversial cases. We'll do a post-show with him. We'll post it online, democracynow.org. Democracy Now! Produced by Mike Burke, Renee Feltz, Nermeen Sheikh, Steve Martinez, Sam Alkoff, Hani Massoud, Karen Dina Gozder, Amy Littlefield.